There you go.
I thank God this morning for the many nurses in the church. Sometimes when I get so excited, I don't eat enough, or they don't eat anything. Sometimes I don't eat nothing. Come on, somebody. Sometimes you get so excited, the Holy Ghost just takes it. Did not stop this morning to eat. It catches up with you. But I do thank God for discerning spirits in the house. I do. First, giving honor to God, to Reverend Thompson. God bless you for being here. Reverend Lucky, God bless you. Reverend Edwards. Reverend Gatewood, Brother Carroll, Minister Davis, God bless you in Jesus' joy. I'm going to ask you to go to your tent doors and help me to preach today. Amen.
Amen.
Father God, this morning help this preacher to preach in Jesus' name. Let the Redeemed Lord say amen. If you were with me two Sundays ago, I started a sermon that I just dropped on you. And it was entitled, Don't Just Do Something, Sit There. Look at somebody and say, Don't Just Do Something,
Sit There.
Sit there.
Sit there.
Well,
this morning, I believe that most of us feel like we need to be busy to be doing something. And for some reason, prayer just doesn't feel busy or active enough. We are a people and our society in which being busy makes us feel like we are worthwhile. If we're not doing something, there's something within us that makes us feel like we are lazy or that we are wasting our time. Help me, somebody. For in our New Testament lesson that Jesus is very busy. In fact, Mark's gospel is the most 21st century compatible gospel that there is. Because Mark gives us the impression that everyone is always in a hurry, help me somebody, and always busy. The word immediately, as I said a couple of weeks ago, appears over 50 times in Mark's gospel. Mark tells the story of Jesus being baptized, and then he says to them, and immediately the Holy Spirit sent him into the desert. Help me, somebody. Then Jesus encounters Simon and Andrew fishing and invites them to be disciples. And Mark says, immediately they left their nets. It says that Jesus heals and casts out demons, and immediately and quickly the news spread about Jesus. And finally, it says, after a fast-paced beginning, and Mark says that very early in the morning, while it's still dark, help me somebody, Jesus got up, look at somebody, said, Jesus got up, left the house and went off to a solitary place and where he prayed. Look at somebody, said, I need to find a solitary place sometimes. I don't know about you that this is absolutely necessary in our busy lives, and it makes our busy lives worthwhile and bearable and more than bearable. Times of being in a solitary and quiet place with God enables us to do work, the work that he wants us to do. Look at somebody, say, it's time to get away. Jesus doesn't just go to the quiet place and solitary place and stay there. Oh, I feel like preaching now. He goes there to recharge his spiritual batteries, and being there enables him to then get up. Look at somebody and say, then get up. And move onto other places to find other places to preach. Do I have a witness right now? Can somebody
today. And know that God is going to help you through anything.
And now, if you think that living life in a fast-paced, busy fashion is only a problem for the modern age, think again. Oh, in the Gospel of Luke, and then I'll go on to my new stuff. There is a wonderful story of Jesus being hosted by sisters Martha and Mary. Jesus comes into their house, Reverend Thompson, and Mary is content to be still and silent and to be with the Lord. And Martha can't do that. Do I have a witness now? She has to be busy. Look at Martha. She has to be busy. She complains to Jesus that her sister isn't helping her to work. The clothes are all over the floor, and the stove is dirty, and the bed is not made. Do I have a witness right now? Everything is unkept and not put away. But I just stopped by just to tell you for a few moments that if God is in your house, you may be able to recognize that he's over there and he doesn't care how the building looks. Martha becomes distracted and upset at many things. And Minister Davis, and so it is with us. Jesus is in the midst of our lives, but we become distracted and upset about many things. I don't know about you, but before I totally surrender, come on, somebody. Before I only 50% surrendered, the other 50% I was worried about other things. Do I have a witness now? But when you turn everything over to God, look at somebody and say 100%. When you turn 100% over to God, God will make a way out of no way for you. Do I have a witness right now? God will do the thing that you thought that will never happen to you. Do I have a witness now? Say, I need to turn 100% over to God. That means my 24-year-old daughter, don't worry about it no more. Turn it over to God. That means my 21-year-old son up at Dartmouth, I need to turn it over to God and leave it there. But then, Reverend Luckett, I can't do that if I don't find a solitary place to recharge my spiritual batteries. Do I have a witness now? How many of you can be honest with me this week, because I got something for you to sign after the service. How many of you, how many of you laid aside for yourself at least one day this week? Come on, don't lie to God. At least one day this week in solitary confinement to give God praise, honor, and glory. Look at somebody and say, I got to recharge. Being still, Sister Danielle, and quiet from time to time is God's will for our lives. We got to stop being busy. Look at somebody and say, we got to stop being busy. First, we need to rest from our work. Help me, somebody. Some of you work until 9 o'clock at night, and your mind is still moving. How many of you go to bed at night and you can't sleep because you don't give your mind rest to rest in God? You're still worried about tomorrow, and you may not make it tomorrow. Can I preach this thing? First, we need to rest from our work and find that solitary place of quiet. Do I have a witness right now? We all need times in our week when we slow down. Look at somebody and say, slow down. And become still and quiet. Because it is vital for our soul. So important is this principle, Avis, that God made the commandment for a day of rest. A Sabbath, which is part of the commandments. How many of you have rested this week and didn't feel bad about it? Yesterday, I stayed in from 12 to 5 o'clock and sat inside of my chair and a half and put my feet on top of my ottoman. And I... How many of you can say that? I fell asleep because God wanted me to. In the middle of a Saturday evening, Saturday, look at somebody say Saturday. That was my Sabbath. That was my rest. My friends, Sister Carolyn couldn't get a hold of me because I turned the phone off.
I turned off law and order. The girlfriends, I turned them off too. Do I have a witness right now? Can somebody tell me right now that you've got to sometimes turn everything off and just give God a few hours of praise, honor, and glory? Sister Davis, I even had some friends of mine who said, did you feel bad? I said, no, because I didn't even know about it. See, sometimes when you rest and you're not thinking about sleeping, that God puts you to sleep. Do I have a witness right now? Is there anybody who ever sat inside of a chair and you just were intending to rest your eyes and all of a sudden you were asleep and 3 or 4 hours later you get up and say, God, I thank you for the sleep. I know I'm right. Didn't even feel bad yesterday. I even deleted my message. Watch out, Reverend. Leave it alone. Checking. Checking. Reverend Thompson, when we have that time in a solitary place, we need to pray. That's what Jesus did. He went to his solitary place to pray. Prayer is not always a matter of talking to God. Listen to me now. Or telling God a list of things. Help me, Bible study. That we need to do for him to do for us. There is a wonderful science fiction writer. His name is Robert Sawyer. In fact, all his books, he will include a page or two, Minister Davis, of subplot that carries with it a profound spiritual insight. I said something. For example, in one of his books, people from Earth are having their first encounters with alien life from other planets. One of the scientists, Reverend Luckett, from the planet Earth is surprised to learn that the aliens not only believe in God, but also spend 8 hours a day in prayer. Look at somebody say, they spend 8 hours a day in prayer. Now, the scientist from Earth, Reverend Thompson, was dumbfounded and he said, what in the world are they asking for that it takes them 8 hours to say? The alien, he was shocked and he said, what does prayer have to do with asking for things? What does prayer have to do with asking for things? It is an interesting insight, but we get so caught up with asking God for things. You are not satisfied with what you have, but you want to add more debt on top of what you have. You know what, Reverend Thompson? We think that prayer is talking to God, giving God a list of things that we want him to do. Heal me from my headache. Make my car last another week. Bring down the gas prices. Come on, somebody. Do something about the violence in my city. Take care of my daughter because she's just not acting right, Lord. Even though that she's just like me. Come on, somebody. Do I have a witness right now? I don't know about you, but sometimes you got to nestle down in the Word of God and say, Lord, I need to learn more about your Word. Show me in the Scriptures where I can be better than what I am now. Sometimes you can't ask God for nothing. Sometimes prayer requires you to just hum there and moan there and tell God, I know I can't do it.
That's right.
Mr. Davis,
I know that's right.
Prayer is spending time with God. Y'all better buy this CD or write this or write this down. It might involve asking for some things.
Go ahead.
It might involve thanking God for things. It might be simply being with God. Do I have a witness now? Have you ever simply spent time with someone?
Yes.
And you are both just quiet?
Yes.
not really saying anything, just quietly being together. Come on, somebody. Perhaps with your spouse. Or holding your child. How many of you held your child when they were younger? And they had a fever or they had a cold. And you didn't say anything for 2 or 3 hours. And all you did was put your hand on the forehead. Help me, somebody. And you prayed to God for healing power. Do I have a witness now? And how many of you sat on the bedside of a sick parent and you couldn't say anything because you knew that they were going on to glory? How many of you just sat there and just communed with God and said, God, I don't know what this is all about, but I'm sitting here, and you put your hand on your mother and your father and you just don't say nothing. Sometimes God wants you to be in his presence to feel his power and to feel his honor. Do I have a witness now? Give somebody a high five and say, sometimes you just gotta just sit there. Look at somebody and say, be still. Sometimes, now listen to me, we need to rest in the bosom of God. Not asking God for anything. Do I have a witness now? How many of you just lay on the floor sometimes and you're laid out and all you do is just spend time with God? How many of you, when you close your door at your job, you don't say nothing and all you do is put on some music and spend a little time with God? Do I have a witness right now? I don't know about you this morning, but I thank God because I was wrestled up in the spirit on yesterday, and I played every song I could get my hands on. I played "There's a Fountain Filled with Blood," song from Emmanuel's vein. Then I said, I won't go back. And then some lady named Gail Holmes, she said, well, whatever it is, let it go. Do I have a witness now? Look at somebody and say, whatever it is, let it go. How many of you have ever laid by the stream and let God feed you? Do I have a witness now? We need more of that time spent with God. And do you know why it is? It's because sometimes God is preparing you by feeding you with what is coming up down the road. Come on, somebody. Because if you don't have anything in your tank, come on, somebody, well, anything is going to knock you off. So that's why every day during the week, at least one time, I want everybody in the house to at least spend 1 hour or so, or 2 hours, or 3 hours. You may not be like the aliens that spend 8 hours, but sometimes you just gotta spend a little time with God and tell the Lord, I know the world has beat me up. I know I'm tired. I know I've run out of gas. So it's time for me now to give you honor and praise. Fill me back up, Lord, with your power. But somebody said, fill me back up, Lord.
Back up.
Elijah.
Hallelujah.
In the Bible, had an interesting experience in the Old Testament book of 1 Kings. The Lord told this prophet, go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord. For the Lord is about to pass by. Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart, Reverend Luckett, and shattered the rocks before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. Can I preach this thing? Well, and the wind there was an earthquake. After the wind was an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. Behind the earthquake came, Mr. Davis, came a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. Do I have a witness now? And after the fire came a gentle whisper and a still, small voice. Do I have a witness now? Look at somebody and say, that's when he was in it. Don't you realize
realize that sometimes God doesn't come in catastrophic ways? Do you have a witness now? But there are times where he will just be quiet and just breathe by in the name of Jesus and calm your spirit. If he'd come in the earthquake, you would have been ruffled up too. But sometimes God's got a blow on you. Do I have a witness now? In a still, quiet voice and let you know that I don't need to come in catastrophic ways, but I can come in a quiet way to calm your spirit. Do I have a witness now? Is there somebody in the house today that know what I'm talking about and that can give God some praise right now? Because you know that God came back at you in a still small voice and just kill him, preach his thing.
But everybody say but.
But
we are too much like Martha. Just as she was in the Gospel of Luke. We are distracted and upset about many things. For we live in a Martha world. When what God would have us to do is just to be still and be quiet. Do I have a witness now? I don't know about you, but it is good for our own soul. It is good for our relationship with us. And it is good for our relationship with God. Several years ago, now listen to this, and I'm almost done. Newspaper told him how a Navy jet fighter shot himself down. He shot himself down. He was flying at supersonic speed, very much like another one I'm going to talk about here. It ran into cannonballs it had fired only a few seconds before. The jet was traveling too fast. What are you saying? Everybody look like he shot some shots. He shot some cannonballs. And he was going so fast that he caught up with the cannonballs and he blew himself up. Do I have a witness now? But what are you saying, Reverend? Sometimes we're going too fast and we catch up with the mess that we put out. Do I have a witness now? So that means that sometimes that you better slow down and wait till God unfolds the plan. Do I have a witness now? Does that mean that I gotta sometime be quiet and lay on my face? How many of you have ever laid on your face and just cried and give God praise? After you put it out there, just after you put it out there, you just sometime gotta just lay down there. I'm so glad I wasn't that pilot. Now, there are times that there are monks who spend time in monasteries, spending lifetimes in their quiet places of solitude and prayer. But for most of us, prayer needs to end with action. See, we think amen means goodbye. You think that it is finished. But I believe that amen means action. Come on, somebody. Look at somebody and say, it's time to go to work. See, we're leaving everything up to God like he's our fairy godfather. But you've got to put feet to your prayer. Do I have a witness now? Oh, I'm preaching now. You've got to put feet to your prayer. He will give you what you want, but sometimes you got to be like the man who was blind. When Jesus went to him and he put mud on his eyes, and he said, now you got to go over and do what? You got to clean off the mud. Do I have a witness now? Sometimes you got to clean off the mud in order to give God his due. Do I have a witness now? You got to slow down and know that God will take care of what you ask him to do.
That's right. He will do it.
No,
that's right. Yeah.
Reverend Lucky, if the Israelites had disconnected from God about the Jericho wall coming down at the conclusion of their prayer, the wall would have never come down. But there needs to be some action at the conclusion of your prayer. The entire army is to march around the city once a day for 6 days. On the seventh day, you are to march around the city 7 times. The first time around, the soldiers must have felt a little foolish.
But they kept marching. Look at somebody and say, but they kept marching. Now, keep in mind, they were silent during the first 6 days. But when, look at somebody and say, but when? But when they entered the bell light, the priest sounded their horns and some shouting followed. Come on, somebody. God was getting ready to bust a move. But they had to be silent to hear his voice. After 7 days of circling Jericho, God delivered on a 400-year-old promise. I said something, somebody better put a pin in that. Because sometimes God may not answer your prayer in your lifetime.
That's right.
Do I have a witness now? This was a 400-year-old promise that God kept to his people. So you may not see what you are praying for your young people, but I just stopped by just to tell you that God will take care of them if you continue to pray. Do I have a witness right now? You may not see it. You may not see it. You may not see it.
That's it.
After 7 days of circling around Jericho, God delivered.
Yeah.
The walls, help me somebody.
It did.
Of Jericho came tumbling down. How many of you have had Jericho walls? Come on, somebody. And your grandmother, and your grandfather, and your great-great-grandfather, and great-great-grandmother prayed for you, and they didn't see the walls come down. But I'll just stop by, help me somebody, just to tell you. When they were in their solitary confinement, they spoke up on Avis and Avis, and they covered Jim. And that may have been 50, 60, 70, 80 years ago. But don't you know, look at you now. Look at the promise that God has kept you. Look at the promise that you have been through now. That's what God will do. If you go to a solitary place and you pray, I just stop by just to tell you that God will answer your prayers. Somebody better say, Now, it's 10 minutes to 12 and I promise to have you out. But I just stopped by just to tell you that God tells you to pray without ceasing. Do I have a witness now? That means, I don't know about you, but every time I get a chance to put a prayer on my lips, tell me somebody, that I'm going to do that thing. Do I have a witness now? Every time that I'm in the middle of a situation and I say, Lord, help me through this thing in the name of Jesus. Don't you know that God delivers and pushes me through? Anybody on my street right now understand what I'm saying? That when you put God first, that God will take care of you. Somebody got to sit down and rest in God. Come on, you got to lay prone to the ground and wait for God to give a word to you.
Yeah, thank you, God.
You know, I was telling a friend of mine, Sister Carol,
you'll do it.
That I thought I knew how to pray. I didn't. And I thought I knew how to pastor. But I did.
It's all right.
Only until I went through the fire.
Jesus.
Come on, somebody help me. Only when I went through the fire last year did I realize pastoring was not what I thought pastoring was. Do I have a witness now? I thought I could walk into the annual conference, get my appointment, and still be all right. But don't you know there are many fraudulent preachers who will give their reports? Do I have a witness now? But what I found out is that I couldn't really know how to pastor until I went through the same thing that my people did. Do I have a witness right now? That I couldn't feel what they feel unless I've been through it. I don't know about you this morning, but I thank God for bringing me through. Do I have a witness right now? And don't you know, this week, Amos, I slowed down. Shut my door. Put the tape in the computer. And get people out of my office. In the name of Jesus. And he brought me through. I don't know about what you came to do. But I need some prayer warriors who can shake it off and give God praise. Sister Purcell, I stopped once on my own. But then God stopped me a second time yesterday. So I had 2 hours, I had 2 days of solitary confinement. Read the word. Relaxed. Sat in my chair and a half. Had enough room to sit there. And just bask in the glory of God. And I've got to give God 100%. Because what I found out, Sister Sharon, is that I can't stand in the place of my son and my daughter. I can't stand. I would love to. But Danielle, I can't stand in their place. All I can do is pray, Sister Abdul. And then what we learned in Bible study, take my hand off of it. The only way that I can take my hand off of it is if I believe that God's going to do what he said he's going to do. Come on, somebody, help me. And you know what I found out, Sister Carol, is that I feel so much better when I'm not carrying around that stuff that I put on myself. Do I have a witness right now? Can somebody help me today? To give God praise right now? There's somebody here happy right now. That God brought you through. Somebody better say yeah. Somebody better say yeah. Somebody better say yeah. Now, Sister Purcell, when I looked at the walls of Jericho and we circled round and round, every brick was a burden that I had. Come on, do I have a witness now? That means every brick that fell, that I let go of what was on my back. Do I have a witness right now? Can somebody help me right now? If you want to get rid of everything, stand up where you are. Say, I want to get rid of everything. Stand up where you are. Say, I want to get rid of everything. Stand up where you are. Say, I want to get rid of everything. Come on, somebody. Let it go. Help me, somebody. Jess, do something. Sit there. And you know, sometimes when you're in the house, I'm blessed. I'm in my house by myself. I can put my shorts on and put no shirt on. Don't you know that when the Lord hit me yesterday, I had just stepped out of the shower. Wow. But I did have time to put my towel around me. And don't you know what happened? See, sometimes you gotta be naked like David. Come on, do I have a witness now? Didn't he dance out of his clothes? Do I have a witness now? And some of you know how big an apartment is. It's not very big. But I ran around that thing. I just kept running. I said, what is happening to me? But somebody prayed for me. And then you know what I also did? I went down to the floor just like this. And I couldn't even move. And then I went like this. And then meant that I surrendered everything. Do we have a witness now? How many of you have been in that position sometimes? That you've got to get rid of everything. You've got to surrender everything. That's the only way that God can use you. Some of you are too busy. And then you look for things that make you busier.
No, I'm not.
Instead of you, you see me. I usually have my cell phone. Ron, give me my cell phone for me. I usually have my cell phone in. And I got a Bible in here.
Yeah.
And I read my Bible. Yeah. Or I got some music on turned very, very low. And don't you know, yesterday, I put this song on here.
Thank you. Hopefully I can hear this thing. Can you guys hear that?
That's what I did yesterday. All day!
Beneath that flood.
Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody.
Tell Sean I want that on the marquee by tomorrow. Don't just do something. We're going to blow the mind of Baltimore. They're going to say, what does that thing mean? Don't just do something. Sit there. Sit there. Let the Spirit come in. Thank you, Howard. Let the Spirit come in. Now, before I do my special thing I got in my little bag, I got in my bag of tricks. I know there's somebody here today that either wants to join Oak Street or give their life to Christ.
Yeah.
First call. And there's somebody who has never given their life to Christ. You have never publicly said that you want to give your life to Christ.
Yeah.
The altar's open now. Is there